Welcome to Smart Catalyst Jan 28, 2018. So today we are going to see all these articles. The first one is Cabinet Nod Likely for Relief Package for the Farmers. The second one is 7 Northeastern States Lag Behind in Toilets Constructions for Schoolgirls. And the third one is No Process to Handle the Plaints Against the Central Vigilance Commission. And the fourth one is Model for Malaria Control. And the fifth one is Bear Watchers Flock to Odisha's Chilika Lake. And the sixth one is Wanted More Judges. And the last one is New Hope for Sickle Cell Patients. So the first article is Cabinet Nod Likely for Relief Package for the Farmers. So what the news here is, the Union Cabinet is expected to soon approve a relief package for the farmers who are struggling with the falling prices of the commodities, as well as to tackle the distress in the farming sector. So what the Union Cabinet is decided to do means, first one is waiving the interest on the crop loans for the farmers. The second one is completely waive the premium for insurance on the food crops. And also the center is evaluating the scheme, which are followed by both the Telangana and the Odisha government recently, wherein a fixed amount is transferred directly to the bank account of the farmers for their cultivation. So now we are going to see what are those schemes which are now done by Telangana and Odisha government. So first one is Telangana's Raitu Bandhu scheme. So instead of announcing farm loan waivers, now the Telangana as well as the Odisha government are making this kind of progressive and inclusive scheme, which will make a direct attack on the poverty by means of massive investment in agricultural sector. Such scheme is this Raitu Bandhu scheme. So this is an agriculture investment support scheme, which is mainly aiming at farmers, and it is also known as Friend of Farmers scheme. So as per this scheme, the state government provides check payments to the farmers based on their land holdings, and the government is planning to provide the money through the check payments and not through the direct benefit transfer. Why? Because the banks might use this direct benefit transfer money to adjust against the farmers' previous dues. So in order to avoid that only, now the government is planning to provide or issue money through this check payments. So one major drawback of the scheme is, in this Raitu Bandhu scheme, every farmer owning the land is eligible, which means it doesn't distinguish between small and the large farmers. That means it doesn't exclude the rich farmers and the wealthy landlords. So they are also now standing in queue to get the benefits. So as per this scheme, 4,000 rupees is provided per acre to the beneficiary as investment support before every crop season. That means twice a year for Kharif and the Rabi crops cultivation, for meet the expenses on seed, fertilizer, pesticide and field preparation for the farmers. So the next scheme is Odisha government scheme, which is the Krushak Assistance for Livelihood and Income Augmentation, which is Kalya scheme. So this actually aims to accelerate the agricultural prosperity in Odisha, as well as to reduce the poverty, especially for the farmers. So as per the scheme, they are aiming to provide 5,000 rupees per acre for both Kharif as well as Rabi seasons for taking up the cultivation, but they are planning to provide it through DBT mode, and it aims at small as well as the marginal farmers of the state. So apart from the farmers who are having the land, the landless laborers or landless households are also be supported through this scheme, which is aiming to provide 12,500 rupees to take up some allied activities like goat rearing, fishery kits for fishermen and women, and mushroom cultivation, etc. So the next article is 7 Northeastern States Lag Behind in Toilets for Schoolgirls. So what the news here is, only 1/3 of the schools in Northeastern States had usable washrooms as of 2018. So it is said by the ASER report, which is the annual status of education report. And as per this report, at least in 2016, they were having like 36% of usable washrooms. But in 2018, it reduced to 34.96%. So in that report, they also stated like Sikkim is performing better because it is having like 75% of usable washrooms, then followed by Nagaland and then Mizoram, and all the other 5 states are performing very poorly. But it is of Northeastern state. But if you see at the national picture, then there are substantial improvements of many school facilities which are visible over this 8-year period after the Right to Education Act of 2010. Because the Right to Education Act of 2010 actually mandated a lot of school facilities, and as per this, there are substantial improvement all over the country. So this is what stated by this ASER report. The next one is No Process to Handle Plaints Against the Central Vigilance Commission. So what the news here is, presently there are no guidelines to handle the complaints of corruption as well as other misconduct against the CVC. So if there are any complaints against the CVC, then there are no guidelines which are in place. So this is said by the Ministry of Personnel in response to an RTI query. So in this context, we have to know about the Central Vigilance Commission. It is an apex vigilance institution and it is an autonomous body which is created via an executive resolution in 1964 itself, and it was conferred with a statutory status in the year 2003. But it is not an investigation agency. So the only investigation carried out by the Central Vigilance Commission is that it examined the civil works of the government. So the civil works of the government is the only investigation which is carried out by the CVC. Okay. And it is a multi-member body which is having a Central Vigilance Commissioner who is the chairperson and not more than 2 vigilance commissioners who are the members. So now we are going to see the functions of CVC. It monitors all the vigilance activity under the union government only, and it advises the various authorities in the union government organizations in planning, executing, reviewing and reforming their vigilance works. So it is the only designated agency to receive the complaints for disclosure on any allegation of corruption or misuse of office and recommend appropriate action in terms of union government. So the vigilance activity which is carried out by the CVC is having certain jurisdictions. So what are those jurisdiction means? The first one is all the members of All India Services who are serving in connection with the affairs of the union, they are coming under the ambit of CVC and the Group A officers of the central government. And two things, one is the PSUs and another one is PSBs. So public sector units, the officers up to 2 grades below the board level, and PSBs, public sector banks, officers of rank of scale 5. So they all are coming under the ambit of CVC. And apart from that, the officers who are having a basic pay of 8,700 per month and above in autonomous bodies or local authorities in central government. So they are all the CVC jurisdiction. And the next article is Model for Malaria Control. So what this article talks about is World Health Organization's World Malaria Report of 2018. So as per this WHO report, among the 11 highest malaria burden countries, India is the only country which saw substantial progress in reducing the malaria disease burden. It is actually achieving like 24% decrease in 2017 as compared to 2016. So this is mainly attributed to the country's owned and country's led program, which is led by our government. And this indicates that India has assumed a leadership role in advancing the global efforts to end malaria. So if you see the background, in 2015 itself, at the East Asia Summit, India has decided to fight against malaria and pledged to eliminate the disease by 2030 completely. And for that, they actually launched the 5-year National Strategic Plan for Malaria Elimination, which actually marked a shift in focus from malaria control to malaria elimination. So under this Malaria Elimination Strategic Plan, Odisha has emerged as an inspiration in the fight against the disease. So Odisha government has actually launched this Daman initiative, which is Durgama Anchalare Malaria Nirakaran initiative. And apart from that, the ASHA workers are also helping to distribute approximately 11 million bed nets, which was enough to protect all the residents in that area, that is in that Odisha area, that were at higher risk during that point of time. So Daman aims to deliver services to the most inaccessible and hardest hit people of the state. And Odisha has recorded actually 80% decline in malaria cases and deaths in 2017. Okay. So this indicates that this Daman scheme is an intensive initiative to combat malaria in hard to reach villages. And it also addressing other problems in one go, like minor ailments of cough, cold, body ache, non-communicable diseases like diabetes, hypertension, severe anemia and severe malnutrition cases, etc. So the next article is Bird Watchers Flock to Odisha's Chilika Lake. So this article talks about the 2-day National Chilika Bird Festival inaugurated by the Ministry of Tourism. So in this context, we have to know about this Chilika Lake. It lies in the east coast of India in the state of Odisha, which covers a part of Puri and Ganjam districts. And it is the largest brackish water lagoon in India. And one thing you have to note here is this is a unique assemblage of freshwater ecosystem, brackish water ecosystem and marine ecosystem in Chilika. So the Chilika Lake has been recognized as a wetland of international importance under the Ramsar Convention. So if any place is declared as a Ramsar Convention, then it is ecologically very sensitive zone, so proper conservation must be done by the government. So that is what it means, okay? The next one is wanted more judges. So this article talks about the vacancies in the subordinate as well as district and high courts. So if you see, well-functioning civil justice systems protects the rights of all the citizens against infringement of the law by others, including by powerful parties and the governments. But in our country, if you see, there are a lot of vacancies in both the lower level courts as well as the high courts. So this article talks about the vacancies in the judicial system. So if you see, well-functioning justice system protects the rights of all the citizens against the infringement of the law by others, including by the powerful parties as well as by the governments. So an essential component of the rule of law is indeed based on effective and fair judicial system to ensure that those laws are protected and respected. But in order to do that or achieve that, there should be enough number of judges in all level of courts. But in reality, in our country, both the high courts as well as the Supreme Court as well as the subordinate courts all are having lot of vacancies of judges. So if you see in this picture, according to the National Judicial Data Grid, in 2018, nearly 2.9 crore cases pending in district and subordinate courts and 47.6 lakh cases pending in high courts. And in high courts, that is in 24 high courts across our country, the sanctioned strength is 1,079, but the working strength is only 695, which is a shortfall of 384 judges. And among that, Allahabad is the high court which is having lot of vacancies across all the high courts. So in this context, we have to know about this judicial data grid. So there are 16,000 judges in the subordinate judiciary and 650 in the higher judiciary, which include both the Supreme Court as well as the High Court. So the purpose of this National Judicial Data Grid is to make all the judgments delivered by a judge available on a publicly accessible National Judicial Data Grid, and it can be moved from one place to another place towards the paperless courts. So that means it is under this e-court project of our government, which is under e-governance. So we are actually planning at Digital India, right? So as per this, e-governance is a part, and under that e-court project is done by the government. And as a part of this e-court only, this judicial data grid is available. So it is basically also used to examine judges' performance on various parameters in order to provide efficient, time-bound, citizen-centric service delivery all across the country. So the last article is New Hope for the Sickle Cell Patients. So this article talks about the sickle cell anemia. So it is an inherited form of anemia. So we all know that our blood is having like cells, red blood cells and white blood cells. And if there are not enough healthy red blood cells to carry adequate oxygen throughout the body, then it is actually referred to as anemia. And this sickle cell anemia is an inherited form of anemia. So if you see in this picture, this is normal red blood cell. But if anyone is getting affected with this anemia, then their red blood cell is shaped as this sickle cell, okay? That means in sickle cell disease, the blood cells are stuffed with hemoglobin or distorted into sickle shapes. So because of this shape, it actually gets stuck in the blood vessels. So as it gets stuck in the blood vessels, it causes strokes, organ damage, and it excruciates the pain, etc., as the muscles are starved of oxygen. So there is no enough oxygen supply, and because of this shape, it is actually blocking the blood vessels, which is causing this organ damage or strokes, etc. So patients who are getting affected with this are severely anemic, and they are prone to infections, and their daily life can be a challenge for them. So what is the solution for this sickle cell anemia is, the immature blood cells are removed from their bone marrows, the affected patient's bone marrows. From there, the immature blood cells should be removed, and they should be genetically modified and infused back into the patient's blood cells. So this modified cells is again take up to the residents in bone marrows, and they now form the healthy red blood cells again in their blood, okay? So this can be treated by two means. One is the gene therapy and another one is the bone marrow transplantation. So if you see in this picture, these are the symptoms of the sickle cell anemia.